to Connie Martin's and Tuck's Books. My guest today has written a most profound book about Eisenhower, David Dwight Eisenhower. It's called Eisenhower, the White House Years. It's published by Doubleday. My guest is Jim Newton. Welcome, Jim.
It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for having me.
Thank you. And you know, anybody who thought they knew Ike Eisenhower didn't know him, won't know him until they read the book.
Thank you. I hope that's right.
First of all, it is the White House years, but you give me almost a précis of the man's years prior. So that he was born, he's a Midwesterner, six brothers, and a mother who hated war. And he gets into West Point because he was 1 point short for Annapolis.
Indeed, it's a curious upbringing for a man who goes on to have the career that he did, obviously. Yeah.
But he was the sort of man that older men took him under their wing and cared and sort of helped him along.
That's very true. The reason that I set the book up with those brief chapters about his upbringing is I don't think it's possible really to understand him as president without understanding some of those formative influences, and many of those were military. Obviously.
And especially in having been at West Point, World War I, and I just said to you, a General Fox Connor was very important in his life.
Yeah, General Fox Connor is one of the underappreciated military figures in American history, I think, especially in that period between World War I and World War II. What Connor was just absolutely terrific at was spotting talent, up and coming potential talent for the military. And what he saw in Eisenhower was a young officer with great potential. And so he lured Eisenhower to Panama, where he was stationed at the time, and then just put him through a real intellectual upbringing, made him read the classics, quizzed him on them, so that when I came to Panama to work for Connor, he was a relatively undistinguished officer, although clearly one with some promise. By the time he left, he really was a military intellectual and went on to, of course...
Mamie, whom he had married, was not thrilled about some of these places she was sent to. And then the one tragic in their life, the death of their son, John.
Indeed. So sad. Icky, as they knew him. Icky died as a toddler meningitis, scarlet fever that turned to meningitis, and neither of them ever really quite got over the tragedy.
Yeah.
In fact, they're buried together with Icky in Abilene today.
And, of course, things that are amusing as you read, his friendship with General George Patton.
What a character Patton was.
Well, there they were as young couples, and they would play bridge. Bridge was his great sport next to golf.
Yes, he needed it for relaxation. He had a very sort of feverish mind, and I think it really helped him to slow down, and he enjoyed company and friends and very much enjoyed bridge.
As I was reading about that, I thought, yes, that is probably why he was really such a good president, because it is that ability to sort of know what's coming, know what you're holding in your hands, and play it with a cool face.
Indeed, and also a great poker player, though he played bridge much more later in life. But I think that's clearly those games of strategy and chance are helpful in his intellectual development.
He goes after the World War II, he ends up being our hero. He becomes president of Columbia University, where they really didn't know what to do with a man without a PhD.
In fact, Eisenhower used to joke that they had offered it to the wrong Eisenhower and then been too embarrassed to take it back. And because, of course, his youngest brother, Milton, was a very distinguished academic who went on to become president of Johns Hopkins, among other places. Milton is the one who really had the background to be the president.
But Herbert Brownell recognizes in Eisenhower a man who has the potential to be a Republican candidate for president.
Exactly. Herbert Brownell had run Tom Dewey's campaigns in the prior years, represented very much that Eastern moderate establishment, the sort of what we would now call the sort of Wall Street establishment of the Republican Party, saw in Ike a comparable figure, a centrist politically, internationalist in his worldviews, as opposed to the isolationist politics of Robert Taft and others. And then, of course, put on top of that, an international hero with whom there is almost no one to compare in the world today. So that clearly was a pretty formidable political resume.
And Eisenhower, though, is dragging his heels. And Brownell says, you better get back here. It's time.
Yeah, Eisenhower had to be coaxed into running. Truman had offered to support Eisenhower in 48 if he ran, under the mistaken impression that he was a Democrat.
Yeah.
Lived to regret that. But yes, Eisenhower began his campaign with a sort of remove. He was in Paris, where he was the first head of NATO. Mm-hmm. People were urging him to come back, and he resisted as long as he could, but Brownell did help to persuade him that at some point he had to return and actively seek the nomination.
Now he is running against Robert Taft, who has already, in his head, sealed the deal. He has all of the people he needs for the votes. And just a minute, there's something called Fair Play Amendment. We're going to seat people who represent Eisenhower as well.
Right. There were several states in which there were two slates of delegates that had been selected, one generally favoring Taft, the other favoring Eisenhower. And the question was, who would be allowed to vote on whether to seat those delegates? And it was Brownell who concocted the strategy, which he brilliantly named the Fair Play Amendment, because it seems very hard to imagine opposing the Fair Play Amendment. So it did a lot to get Eisenhower elected.
Yeah. He ends up being nominated, and he runs, and poor Adlai Stevenson didn't stand a chance.
That's true.
And it was Ike all the way.
Yeah, not close. You almost feel for Stevenson in it. And I have to say, if I'd been alive and voting in 1952, I would have been tempted to support Stevenson. In many ways, his politics are similar to my own.
Yeah.
But I think the renown that Eisenhower brought, combined with his sort of winning personality, and you know, there, as I say, it's very hard to replicate having defeated Hitler in World War II. So all of that combined to really make Stevenson
Elected, he's in office, he's in the White House. And there are certain problems with a man named Joe McCarthy and with the Rosenbergs and the whole anti-communist feel.
Yes, of course, he comes to office in the middle of the Korean War. McCarthy has a full head of steam at that point. So the issues of domestic security and the threat of international communism, both internationally and domestically, were very much at the center of the American agenda. And among the most problematic issues for Ike to deal with in those first couple of years was how to handle Joe McCarthy.
Yeah.
He had no supervision over him, couldn't fire him. He was a United States senator. So what could he do to contain him and ultimately reduce the threat of McCarthyism without doing something that would cause McCarthy to have even more prominence. And so that really dictated his strategy toward dealing with McCarthy.
As well as the Rosenbergs.
The Rosenbergs convicted while Truman was president, but yes, they were still alive when Ike became president. There were many appeals to him to either give them clemency or to pardon them. The cabinet did debate it, never really got serious about it in the sense that there was never any serious move to actually give them clemency, but they did discuss it at great length on a couple of occasions. And ultimately, of course, Eisenhower made the decision to allow them both to be executed.
Yeah. His Secretary of State is John Foster Dulles. And there are problems in where they come into Iran. I mean, it's ironic to read about it now.
It is.
Yeah. They get rid of, or they want to get rid of a man named Moissadegh. And they do.
Yes, the Eisenhower defense strategy, concocted quite early in the administration, was really had three major parts. It tried to reduce manpower in the U.S. military in order to save money to help balance the budget. A more heavy reliance on nuclear weapons in order to deter Soviet communism, particularly in Europe. And then finally, and most controversially, the reliance on covert action to try to roll back communism or prevent its spread, particularly in the Third World. The first example of that was the overthrow of Mossadegh, the fairly elected prime minister of Iran. And yes, the administration, with quite little effort, frankly, pushed him out of power and really whetted their own appetite for covert action. They went on to practice it in other countries after that. And I do think it's one of the most unfortunate pieces of the Eisenhower foreign policy and one of its worst legacies.
Yeah. How were you able to find out all of the so-called covert actions?
Some of them, most have been declassified over the years because so much time has gone by. There are some records associated with the covert actions and with the nuclear weapons program and some other aspects of the administration that are still classified. There is a process by which an author or anyone else can urge an appeal or levy an appeal for declassification. And in a number of instances, I asked for documents to be declassified that upon review, the government agreed to declassify and I relied on them for the book.
Yeah. There's a great picture here, too, where prior to being president, when he hears that Truman has fired MacArthur.
It's my favorite picture of the book.
Yeah.
It really is, because what it captures is the absolute lack of dismay on Eisenhower's part. He, as you mentioned earlier, he had a number of mentors. Where are we seeing? This isn't the page with the MacArthur picture on it.
No, it's on another page.
Oh, yeah, different. There's some nice art in there, too. In fact, there's John Foster Dulles. In the case of MacArthur, MacArthur is someone who he learned not to emulate. In fact, he used to say that his time with MacArthur was a study in theatrics. And MacArthur used to say of him that he was the best clerk I ever had.
There's also what happened later with here's the picture with
That's him receiving the news of MacArthur.
Yeah.
Yep.
In the presidency, Nixon was his choice. That was surprising too.
Yes, his relationship with Nixon is very complicated, and there were a lot of ambivalent feelings or contradictory feelings. He admired Nixon's loyalty. He admired his intelligence. Nixon performed quite admirably after Ike had a heart attack in 1955, and Eisenhower was very grateful for that. Nixon was very restrained in how he handled himself in that period. And yet, in 1956, Eisenhower gave very serious thought to dropping Nixon from the ticket. He actually thought it would be good for Nixon to have a role leading a department rather than just playing the understudy to Eisenhower. So they sort of go back and forth. Yeah. There, as I say, it's a real mixture of appreciation and a kind of paternalism. There's a moment that some people will recall in the 52 campaign when the so-called slush fund controversy almost ended Nixon's political career. Ultimately, Nixon gives the famous Checkers speech from here in Los Angeles and fights and keeps his place on the ticket. But when Ike greets him in West Virginia to welcome him back to the ticket, effectively, he says, Nixon looks up surprised to see him there and says, oh, you're here. And Eisenhower says, of course I'm here. You're my boy. And that idea that he's his boy, that he's somehow a subordinate, that very much runs through their relationship. I never saw him as an equal.
Heart attack. That was really a shock in the first term.
Absolutely, yes.
Yeah.
There had been questions about Ike's age when he ran. Now, he was only 62 when he ran, so we wouldn't think much of it anymore. But in the day, he seemed older. And then he had the heart attack, and that raised real questions about his ability to continue. He's quite serious. He was out of office for 3 months and quite seriously thought about not running in 1956. His advisors all urged him to run. His brother Milton actually did not. His brother Milton thought he should step down. He considered it, once he decided to run, though, then the only thing I think that could have stopped him would have been another really serious question about his health.
But he was sharp enough to use television at that point. Mm-hmm. He didn't get out on the train rides.
Right. He knew he had to limit himself. And he was more limited in the second term. Not only did he have a heart attack, he also had a stroke and a very serious bout of something called ileitis, an intestinal disorder that had bothered him his whole life.
In his career as a politician, I wondered about, and that is after he makes Earl Warren in the Supreme Court Chief Justice, and his attitude about school integration.
Again, a very complicated, long story. It's my view that Ike, while not personally very enlightened on issues of race, ended up compiling a record that is actually better than his own instincts in some ways. As you mentioned, he appointed Earl Warren to the court. He also put on William Brennan and three other justices named.